Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Benvenuti a tutti. I'm Ron Seggi from the Ron Seggi Show in the USA and a proud sponsor of the Italian Family History Group. Welcome to Palace Cinemas for the March 2016 event featuring our special guest, Dr. Lucia Barbera. Please take your seats and please take a moment to turn off your phones. We hope you enjoy the evening.
Welcome, everyone. Buonasera, e signori, e signore. Benvenuti a tutti. Thank you all for coming this evening, because I know it's very close to Easter, and that the Italian Family History Group appreciates your time and interest in what we do. Your support for Coesa and the History Group is greatly appreciated. The film that you were viewing earlier is a film produced by one of our committee members, a great filmmaker named Antonio Luciano, called Wine Trails of Italia, episode 8. Called Sicilia, which is perfect because our guest speaker is actually from Messina originally. And of course, the intro music that you heard is a famous piece of music, which is the Tarantella, which was transcribed by Franz Liszt, a German composer of all people, because they don't know who the original composer was, but it's one of the most famous Italian pieces that we all know and love. And of course, this evening we have Dr. Lucia Barbera, who's from Messina, who actually has done her PhD, and she's here to share some really interesting research knowledge that she has spent years doing about abandoned children, the history of foundlings, and child welfare, with a focus on Sicilia in the 19th century. Dr. Barbera holds an international PhD in the history and social institutions and cooperation for development from the University of Messina, and also an advanced master's degree in institutions and policies for human rights and peace from the University of Padua. Correct? Sì. So tonight we will explore the evolution and the concept of childhood throughout the centuries in Europe and Italy, with specific focus on the pioneering child care system, which spread throughout Sicilia during the Bourbon period, 1734 to 1860. And just recently, Dr. Barbera published a lovely book, which she will talk about in her presentation and sell some at the end of the evening. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Dr. Lucia Barbera to the stage. Thank you.
Thank you all for coming to listen to my presentation. I hope you will enjoy and you will find it interesting. Tonight I'm going to share with you my historical research. It was very hard for me when I started, because when I first went to speak with the director of the Messina State Archive, he told me, Lucia, your topic is very, very interesting, but it will be very difficult for you to find the documents, because it's like to look for a needle in a haystack. And so, good luck. Hope for you all the best. But then, you know what? Thanks to my passion on this topic, I was able to find a lot. I was able to find also an archive, that was just buried in a canteen of Messina. So I've found also many archives, actually. And also it helped for the history of Messina, but also for history of Sicily. and much more for history of Europe, because comparing what I did with other studies, what I'm telling you is just very interesting, because it also could be considered what in Sicily happened, very important from a historical point of view, also worldwide, because it was activated a very good welfare child welfare system. But before to start, I want to dedicate my presentation to children of the past, of the present, and of the future. But being here, I think it is for me very important to speak tonight in honor of these babies that were recently abandoned here. So we are speaking tonight about history, but also you will see how much actual it's what I'm going to tell you tonight. So here you can find the history that maybe you know very well, about the 5-day-old baby boy who, for miracle, survived after being dumped down a drain by his mother, and he was found, he is still alive. But it was not so the destiny of a baby girl that was then called by the police Lily Grace, that was found buried in sand in South Maroubra Beach by two nippers on the 30th November 2014. And then, more recently, we have this 3-day-old baby boy found by two grieved grandparents in a pink bassinet outside this front door. Infant exposure, that means infant abandonment, is something that is as old as history itself. It is really distasteful to the modern conscience, I know, and also shocking when we hear about it in current news. But you know what? Also in our mythology, we have histories about abandonment of babies. Maybe most of you know about the story of Moses, that was abandoned in the Nile River in a vessel. Maybe most of you know the history of Romulus and Remo, the founders of Rome, that were abandoned in the Tiber River, and then they were fed by a wolf. And so also in mythology we have references about abandonment of children. And also in ancient cultures we can have this kind of phenomenon. And there were laws governing child abandonment that was permitted or condemned depending on the type of political and social organization. For example, I put here that some references about Jewish, where the exposure was allowed, and also child selling, but it was not permitted the abortion and the infanticide. On the other side, we have Greeks and Romans that allowed exposure, that means the abandonment of children, allowed the abortion, and allowed as well the infanticide. Then, in the 4th century, we had the widespread of Christian values, and despite the child selling was allowed by their parents, we have laws forbidding abortion, infanticide, and the abandonment that were considered crimes. And there were also there was also the establishment of laws to help foundlings or laws to support poor parents. And this was very good, actually. Moreover, thanks to the widespread of Christian values, such as brotherly love, that in Latin is pietas, and charity towards suffering souls, we have the birth of the first institutions that hosted abandoned babies. And these institutions were called brefotrophia, that were actually foundling homes. So, what about the etymology of the word? This word derives from the Greek, and it is made up of two words, brephos, meaning newborn, and trepho, meaning to feed. So, these places were institutions where children were fed and hosted. And here we have a definition as well, assistential institutions intended to house bambini esposti, so because abandoned children were called also in documents bambini esposti, meaning exposed children, that were actually figli d'ignoti, so children of unknown parents, because they were abandoned and the parents didn't leave anything to know about them. And here in the photo you can find the brefotrofio of Florence, that is called l'Ospedale degli Innocenti. Going to Florence you can also see a beautiful exhibition there about i bambini esposti. Okay. So what about these kind of institutions? When do we have the first ones in Italy, but also in Europe? So the first one was founded in the 8th century in Milan by the archipriest Ateo that founded the Xenodochio. Then in Milan as well, we have in the 12th century another example of this kind of institutions. In the 12th century in Rome, the Pope Innocent III founded the Ospedale di Santo Spirito in Sassia. And then there was the widespread of these kind of institutions in other cities of Italy, such as in Florence, that is the one you saw just a minute before, l'Ospedale degli Innocenti. Then in Naples we have a very important institution. Fix in mind this because we are coming back to tell much more about the Real Casa dell'Annunziata. And then, so after the widespread in Italy, we have also a very big diffusion in Europe, in France, in Spain, in Portugal, in London as well in the 18th century, that Thomas Coran founded. The Foundling Hospital was the name of the institutions. So, which were the causes that created this kind of phenomenon? Why people abandoned their children? Because they were babies born out of wedlock, so this was a great reason in the past for people to abandon their children, because of the that was considered a disgrace for the person, for the unwed woman, and also for her family. And it was also a question of the dishonor. So that baby that was considered a bastard was an illegitimate. So it was one of the first causes that created this kind of situation. Then we have also the abandonment of children that were actually legitimate, and parents abandoned their children for poverty and hunger, because they were actually unable to feed their children during the period of nursing. Other reasons could be sickness of the baby or of the mother. The father could be far away in prison, or another kind of situation could be the mother's death during childbirth, wars, pandemics, epidemics, and outbreaks. But don't forget also the situations when we had the relationships between masters and servants, or unwed women with married men, or unwed women with priests. In my documents, in the document I analyzed, there were a lot of priests that were the fathers of the babies that were abandoned. So these were the main causes, much more. And these kind of situations created a big shame in the past for families, and in particular for the honor of the unwed woman. Where children were abandoned, most of them at the beginning in the past were abandoned in public places, because in these public places they could be noticed by someone, and could be, for example, could happen this on the streets, on a doorstep, or on the steps of a church. But because with the time, this kind of abandonment in public places became also punishable, so people had to pay a fine if they were discovered, or they could risk also imprisonment, so they prefer to abandon their children in those institutions I showed before. So in Brefotrofi, that were the foundling hospitals. And here they abandoned their children through two ways. One way could be via the convenience office, and here the babies were brought by midwives or that were born at home or in the maternity units, where it is very, very interesting, this that I have found for Messina. In maternity units, some rooms were for the partorienti velate, meaning veiled laboring women. So there were women that were unwed women, pregnant, waiting to give birth to their babies, that had their face completely covered, because they don't want to reveal their identity because of that. And then people that wanted to abandon the babies used a lot this kind of system made up of the foundling will. It seems strange, but now I'm going to explain to you what it means. So when do we have the first will in Italy? And I can say also in Europe. We have that in the 12th century, because it was founded by the Pope Innocenzo III. Why? He was really shocked to know that fishermen found babies floating in the Tiber River. So he thought, we have to do something, we have to face this problem. It's a shame, it's incredible that something could happen. And he thought that the best way to face this kind of problem was to allow people to abandon their children, respecting the secret of the identities of people that were abandoning the babies. So other names of the ruota, the wheel, were in other cities of Italy: Rota, Torno, Buca, Presepio, Pila, other names of this kind of system. So how was this wheel? It was a wood cylinder set up right in the outside wall of the building. It was rather like a revolving window that we can see, maybe much more in Sicily, in the convents of nuns. They exist still in some convents. And the baby was placed just in this wood cylinder, and the person that abandoned the baby was not seen but by the person that was inside the building, because this person abandoning the baby turned the wheel and then pulled a cord on the outside of the building, causing an internal bell or chimes to ring, to alert actually the caretaker that was most of the time a woman, midwife, called in Sicily ruotara, because she was looking after the ruota, so ruotara because of that, or in other cities could be also called ricevitrice de proietti, pious receiver of proietti. What does it mean? Cast-offs. It was the much popular name given in Sicily and in Lazio to abandoned children, because they were projected, thrown away, thrown out. That's the meaning. So this kind of system that was really, really respectful of the identity of unwed women rapidly spread also in the southern European countries. Why this? Where? In particular in Catholic countries. Because the church really supported this kind of system. It was very important for the church to protect the identity, to protect a life, first of all, then to protect the identity of the wed woman, to protect the family of the woman from the shame of the community. So we have a great spread in Catholic countries. This didn't happen in Germanic and Anglo-Saxon countries. Why? Because there was a system that previewed a paternity proceeding and economic support for poor parents. So there we don't have actually the system of the foundling wheel existing. That's incredible. There was a widespread that in the first half of the 19th century, Italy had 1,200 foundling wheels, so spread everywhere. How many children we have in the centuries 18 and then 19? The number really increased from the 17th century to the 19th century, that reached this 19th century, the maximum level. And in fact, you have to note that it was also called by historians the century of foundling, because of this high rate of foundlings. It's unbelievable. And also, so the number, 10 million children abandoned. The cause, the main cause was also that in that century we face a strong population growth in Europe. And what studies also reveal is that This high rate was much more common in the cities than in the countryside. Why this? Because most of the unwed women lived in the countryside, so the cities attracted the unwed women. They left their village to go and give birth far away from their little village, to come back then when everything was done. So because of that, we have a high rate in the cities than in the countryside, and then because the cities were provided by foundling institutions, the ones I presented before. Public intervention. So, as you have seen before, from the 13th century to the 17th century, we have the birth of these institutions for foundlings that at the beginning they were just moved as institution that were given for charity. I spoke about the Christian values. But then, with time, we have much more an intervention by the public governments. So we assist to a movement from charity to assistential institutions. What happened in Sicily, that was my great case study? I didn't think, I didn't think to find all these. It was incredible for me in my research that I just started with the little steps, and then what I'm telling you is a lot great. Childcare in Sicily institutions and mediators. So Sicily assisted to a public intervention in this kind of system to in favor of foundlings in the 1751. I can tell you that the system that spread out in Sicily was a pioneering at a European level, and I can tell you also at a world level, because for the first time we have a public intervention. For the first time, we have legislation on foundlings and creation of a public child care system. As I explained to you, there was this kind of system, but was linked with religion, with charity. For the first time, we have a public child care system. So, how was it founded? It was founded during the Kingdom of Carlo III of Spain, by the Viceroy Eustachio de la Vifuille, under the advice of the Canon Emanuele Cangiamila. On the 11th of January 1751, we have the foundation of the Deputazione dei Bambini Proietti, meaning that we had the institution of a big commission, big deputation of the foundlings. It was placed in Palermo, and it was composed by a prelate and four nobles. Think that I have studied all the elections there were in this deputation. We had, for all the duration of this deputation, the princes of Lampedusa taking part to this deputazione. What the law said, it was that we had to create deputazioni locali dei proietti, so local deputation for foundlings, in every city and part of the kingdom. And in every city and village of the kingdom, the law wanted that there was the activation of a public foundling will. So in every single village, there was in the past a will, even if there wasn't hospitals, there was the will. So I'm sharing with you the documents I have found buried in the archives. This is an essay where you can see It's like to an advertising for other European countries to do what in Sicily it was just the child care system. And here we have also what I've found in the archive, the compendium of the laws on the foundlings. Once again, here there was a compendium up to date. So, in the 19th century, there were Spedali per Trovatelli, Foundling Hospital, in Palermo, Catania, in Messina, the main cities, and wheels everywhere, including Trapani, Siracusa, Agrigente, Caltanissetta, that are other main important cities of Sicily. And here it's a cute image because you can find a woman going to the wheel in the act to abandon her child. So, here I wanted just to share with you what the documents said about this will. So, la ruota deve essere posta nel mezzo di un muro di una casa abitabile. So, the will had to be placed in the middle of a wall of a livable house in a comfortable place, but not so much public. Yeah, you know why. Deve essere capace di ricevere un bambino nato di fresco. Nato di fresco. So, it has to be capable to receive a newborn. Dovendo stare aperta, so it had to be opened senza il minimo impedimento. So, without any impediment, yeah. In qualunque tempo e specialmente la notte. So, always the will had to operate. It's like to say 24/7. In un luogo ben visto dal parroco. So, the priest has to check always this will. And also i giurati. I giurati erano di the local administrators. Okay. What else? So, this is actually the will you can still say in Naples, in the Real Casa dell'Annunziata. It is a will of the 17th century, still there, that people can see in that institution. Can you see the opening? Can you see how small it is? I discovered that actually sometimes not only newborn babies were abandoned. It depends on the cases and on the causes. There was also the abandonment of older children. And because this opening was so small, they were covered in oil in order to slide into this small opening and enter into the institution. So, la ruotara. La ruotara was the mistress of the will that for the Sicilian laws had to be a femmina onesta and a honest woman approved by the local parish priest responsible for the first care and assistance service. She was mediator with the public institutions in charge of the children's support, and the children's support, the public children's support, lasted 5 years for males and seven years for females. So it happened that if the ruotara worked for the council, once taking in the child, in the casa dei proietti, presented this baby to the officials of the local administrative commission, giving all the details regarding the child, the clothes of the baby, and everything was documented in written record. This commission then entrusted the baby to a wet nurse who took care of this baby and breastfed him or her receiving a monthly salary. If Devotara worked for a foundling hospital, she communicated the reception of the baby to the responsible of the foundlings, and in Messina was at the beginning a priest called the Padre dei Trovatelli, so the father of foundlings, and then we had a person called the Censore di Settimana, weekly censor. I'm showing you now. This is one example of recording book that was filled in by the Censore di Settimana, that recorded everything about the arrival of the baby, specific recording books like this. Here he listed the clothes left with the babies, any identifying marks left with them that were called segnali, signals. The day, the hour, the way they were left, and most important, whether they had been christened or not. And usually they knew this by the presence of a little note called polizza. Or, think about it, also they knew if a baby was christened by the presence of salt. The documents said that. So, the abandoned children sometimes were left in rugs involved in le fasce, as documents said. Literally, it means wrapped in swaddling clothes. But this was for poor babies. As I told you before, sometimes the babies were born out of wedlock, from relationships between, for example, a noble and a servant. And these kind of babies could be often dressed in fine clothes of linen and wool with the colorful embroidery and lace. Here there is an example of polizza and the language of the abandonment. So these are kind of segnali that could be found with the baby, and they were a proof for the possible future identification from the parents. So most of the babies that were found with these kind of signals were babies that had legitimate origin. Why this? Because people were so poor that left their babies for the period of the nursing. And then, when it was finished, they came back showing the signal they left with the baby and take back. I'm showing you what, for the first time, I have discovered in the abandoned books of the Brefo Trophy of Messina. So I was the first one to open these books and to discover which signals were left with the babies abandoned in Messina. So here we have, I have written down some history. So this baby, for example, was left on the 28th of February, 1877, 8 a.m., how did this baby arrive from the will, and then we have quality, form, and colors of the clothes, so which kind of signals were left with the baby that had the rotara, and which was the sex of the baby. In this case we have a male. He was 27 days old, and health of state was infermino, that means a little bit sick. Nome e cognome imposto, it means name and last name imposed by the weekly censor, was Placido Leso. So we have a normal name, and then an invented last name. Placido, the name. Leso, meaning injured, was the last name. Unfortunately, we know that this baby died in Savoca, that is close to Messina, on the 7th of June 1877. So in Savoca, he died there because he was entrusted to a wet nurse living there, because of that. So here, quickly, I'm going to show you other kind of signals. This was written in English, for example. It was called Maria Little. As you can see, it was found full of ribbons. These were her signals. And she was called Maria Little. Here I have even found some hair. So, it could happen that, that these kind of signals were different of nature. They could be cut, for example, coins cut in half, jewels, pieces of fabric, small bags containing relics of prayers, holy pictures like this that was cut in half, that is the Madonna della Lettera, the protector of Messina. And we can also find pleas of the parents asking the best possible treatment for the baby. So, before to be entrusted to a wet nurse, a baby had to go through an identification procedure. And this kind of identification was called impiombatura, that means splice. So the baby received a necklace similar to this, affixed in such a manner that it could not be removed. It was of thick silk cord, and then the ends were joined with a lead medal like this. On one side of the medal, we had the symbol of the council or the symbol of the foundling hospital. On the other side, there was the number of identification of the child, of the child that received upon admission, and the year also of admission. But there was a short period where in Sicily was experimented for the first time also the earrings. So the ears of the babies were pierced by a specific earring with a number and the year of the admission. But because then the boys could be stigmatized by the society, even having the earring when they were older, then laws decided to come back to this kind of system called impiombatura. And you have to know also that this kind of system was established in 1771, because before in Italy, but also in Europe, babies were identified by tattoos. To avoid possible frauds from the wet nurses that could change the babies to have the monthly salary. For example, they could replace a foundling with another baby. So this is a kind of medal that I found belonging to a baby of the Brefotrofio of Messina. So, before to be entrusted to a wet nurse, a baby had to do this identification procedure, but he was also christened, and he or she was given a name. A name that could be the saint of the day, and then this name could be followed by a last name that in the first period recalled the status of foundling. So for example, taking my name, a baby girl could be called Lucia Proietti. As I told you before, Proietti, meaning cast-offs, it recalled the foundling status. And it's very spread, this last name. in Lazio, for example, or Sicily. Then other kind of last names recalling the status of foundling were Trovato Trovatello, a lot in Sicily, Abbandonata, Esposto Esposito, Real Casa dell'Annunziata di Napoli. Oh, Esposito, it means that this last name was given to those babies abandoned in that kind of institutions that there was in Naples. So it was given to those babies passing through that will you have seen before, and they were called Esposito. Innocenti were called those babies passing through the will of Florence, most of them. Incogniti, Colombo, those babies abandoned in Messina because the dove was the symbol of the Prefotrofio of Milan. Then we have della Scala, most of them assigned in Siena. These babies were stigmatized a lot by the society because of these last names. Even if the kids were given with these last names, they were recognized, you know? So, we could have, for example, Milingiana I found in Sicily, that means, in Sicilian dialect, eggplant. So, the entrusting to the wet nurses had to be healthy, honest women with buon latte, good milk, had to be married with the wind or dead child. So, in the hospital of Messina, we had two types of wet nurses, in-house that stayed on the hospital, in the hospital, and the outside wet nurses that took the baby and cared him in their homes. Until when? As I told you before, until 5 years for males and 7 years for females in every city and village of the Sicilian kingdom. Then, what happened to these babies? If they were not adopted by the families that took care of them, especially women were came back. Because, why this? Can you imagine that? Because for girls, families had to pay a dowry. So it was too much expensive to maintain a girl instead of a boy that could be a workforce in the farm. So the girl foundlings, called proiette settenarie because the public system financed the wet nurses until the age of 7 years for them, were entrusted to the bishops. Why? For their spiritual, moral, cultural education. Lived in conservatories of the honor, conservatories of their virginity. For boys, we have that they were entrusted to the council's administrators, sent to learn a trade or farming techniques, and they could live in specific assistential institutions. Here, the boys had a really hard military life, but they also could learn music, could learn how to tailor, how to make shoes, how to print. After the unification of Italy in 1861, there was a big debate on the will that contrasted abolitionists and anti-abolitionists. The first ones consider the will out of date, old-fashioned, that didn't prevent infanticide but legalized that because there were a lot of babies that died inside the institutions. But in the south of Italy, in Sicily, we had still the will until the 1923, in the period of Mussolini. Here there was such a kind of document that established finally the closure everywhere of the wills. So, final considerations. I told you before, we are starting to do a journey in the past. And here you can find that the will that was closed for moral, financial, and health reasons then, nowadays, became back in a modern form and more technological as well. And it is experimented, for example, in many, many hospitals of Italy and also in other countries. We have this new form of wills for foundlings that are called culle per la vita, so cradles for life. The modern will that you can see here is equipped with heat sensors which alert doctors and nurses to a new arrival. This is the reference about the exhibition in which I was the scientific coordinator. So we organized this exhibition for the Christmas period, and nowadays it's permanent in the former place of the Prefotropium Messina. I thank you so much for your attention.
What a fantastic presentation. Wow. Jeez. A big round of applause to Dr. Barbera. What actually was your passion? How and why did you end up researching this, first of all? Because you have a passion for this, right?
Yeah, so. Because as you knew before, I did a master's degree in the University of Padova on human rights. I was involved directly on children's rights protection. And so, yeah, thank you for this question. So, while I was working on the protection of children's rights in the office of the Ombudsman of Minors of Venice, I found really surprising to see the word NN. Hmm? It means nomen nescio. I don't know the name. So actually for the office was a way to say this baby was abandoned, so we have to provide legal protection, no? So for the office. But then what I discovered was this, that until the 1955, Italian people that were not recognized by their parents had in the in their documents of birth and in their identity cards this NN after the name, you know, name Lucia, last name NN. So I don't know the name. So it was it meant this person has not paternity. Okay, because you know, until that moment in our identification, I was not born, but there was the reference of the paternity. Now, then disappeared thanks to Lina Merlin. Lina Merlin, that in Italy in 1958 was famous to abolish the legalized prostitution.
Really?
So,
wow.
Yeah. So maybe our ancestors, in their own identity, could have
and yeah. What an interesting, yeah. Wow, that is absolutely interesting. I think I heard this before.
When did the Culla per la Vita start?
Culla per la Vita?
Yeah.
So Culla per la Vita was established by Movement per la Vita in the 1990s, in that kind of period.
Right. Was there anything in between the 20s and up to that point where...
As I told you, there was the presentation of the baby through via the convenience office, so directly.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So what happened with the illegitimate children in that period? So in 1923, was it, when they changed, they closed all the...
They were entrusted to the wet nurses, and then they could be adopted. And no, there was the secrecy, because... for the law, and for Italian law still existing in many countries, a person that gives a birth and doesn't want to be nominated, yeah, could do that, can do that. And for think about this, in this moment for a person, there is no possibility to know about the identity, because the law says you have to wait 100 years. Well, you know what? When I was doing my PhD research, I was even called by a man 78 years old, and I thought it was a joke, but he had my numbers by a lawyer that listened to me in a seminar. Then I discovered it was not a joke. He told me his history, and he told me that in a little house there were four different babies with four different last names. It means that for that family of farmers, it was you know, a way to have also money and then workforce. So he told me, I don't want to die as an unknown. As I've been until the 1955, it was a big show. So it was really touching, yeah.
Wow. That's absolutely amazing. Okay. A question here, Lucia.
My mom was a wet nurse. My uncle, or my dad's uncle, mm-hmm. His wife couldn't have children. So they got a woman to have a baby.
Yeah.
The woman died at birth, when my little cousin, now it's, you know, she's a cousin, okay,
mm-hmm.
When she was born. So they had to have I was born in February, 4th of February. She was born 24th, which is, I think, tomorrow, her birthday, a month later, better than this later. The other little story that I might be interested, my husband's nonno was actually a prince, we only found out.
Oh.
In Sicily, mm-hmm. He was born, his princess, the Sicilian,
yes.
In Ragusa, mm-hmm. In those parts of Ragusa, Siracusa,
mm-hmm.
Not quite sure where. She had an affair with one of the, you know, the servants,
yeah.
And so she had this baby.
Mm-hmm.
But as he grew a little bit older, he didn't want to, you know, they wanted him to work in the land. But he didn't want to, he was a priest. So he went to America. When he was 18, he said, this is not for me, I don't want to, you know, dig the garden and that. So he went to America. And then, in the end, he had about 4 kids.
Wow.
And then he came back when he was older. And of course, in the meantime, he brought lots of money and the family was really well off. And so we found out only a couple of years ago that my husband was actually the grandfather was the priest.
But I just want to mention the fact that I have an elder brother who's a priest. Mm-hmm. He's 93 years of age and retired. He's been in the habit for the last few years of saying Mass once a month at Kellyville for those women who lost their babies. I don't think many people know much about that. So it's just an interesting little point.
So big round of applause. Thank you all very much for coming, and we hope to see you in April. So I'll invite everybody to come. Thank you.